Paul Fishwick comes to us today from the University of
Texas, Dallas.
Texas at Dallas, okay.
Yeah.
As distinguished university chair of arts and technology. Is that cool or what? And as professor of computer science. He has 6 years of industry experience as a system analyst working at Newport News Shipbuilding and at NASA Langley Research Center in Virginia. His PhD was in computer and information science from UPenn. He is active in modeling and simulation, as well as in the bridge areas spanning art, science, and engineering. He pioneered the area of aesthetic computing, resulting in an MIT Press edited volume in 2006. He's a fellow for the Society for Computer Simulation, chair of the Association for Computing Machinery's Special Interest Group in Simulation, and a frequent keynote speaker at a variety of conferences. Fishwick has over 230 technical papers and has served on all major archival journal editorial boards related to simulation. And without further ado,
Thank you
for coming this
way. All right, so I'm going to be talking about a way to sort of think about computing in maybe a different way than is common in the digital humanities. And just as a sort of, I guess, I needed to mention, if anyone wants to interrupt me, I would welcome that. Please do. I always find that to be easier while I'm talking, and then, because that's what I'm here for. I'm here for not just to stand in front of the podium, but to talk with you. So I don't know, I'm calling it, the humanities digital. It's a way to look at it, I suppose, because computer science, couple of the messages that you'll see in this talk are, one is that computer science can be influenced. Not only can it sort of be as a tool, which is probably the way that is most common in DH, but it can work the other way around as well. There are things going on in the humanities, especially history, culture, and philosophy, that have the potential to enhance computer science. So I'll be talking about that. So to some extent, I guess I see that I'm moving in the other direction. So I'm using the metaphor of the salmon to suggest that I'm. Whereas maybe mainstream digital humanities is going downstream, I'm headed in the other direction, and we'll kind of see where that goes. So I'm going to come at this from a computing angle, and I will go into areas of culture and design and humanities where I can. But I wanted to start with a sort of general, this is the way that the country is pitching computing. And this is actually from Pathways to Success, Associate ACM, 2014. So a very, very recent publication. Of course, because it's ACM, they're pushing computing, obviously, and they're saying by 2020, one out of every two STEM jobs will be in computing. And the other thing is computer science education is fundamental. It's the key to the country in success and innovation. So Those are sort of messages or a rhetoric that suggests that the computing is important in our lives, and we all sort of know that we have laptops, we have tablets, we have phones, and they're all computers. But can we think about computing a little differently? So, what's kind of a key problem that I've seen? I've seen this when I was at Florida. I see it at Dallas, and students run away from a lot. When I'm into arts and technology, what I'm doing is I'm a bridge between engineering and arts and technology. And we have a lot of students, about 1,200 of them in arts and technology, that take computer science to learn programming, to bring back into arts and technology to do everything from digital humanities to games and animation studies. We have a new faculty member, Max Sheik, and he does cultural humanities, a bit like Lev Manovich, that sort of approach. But a big problem is most of the non-STEM students, and includes the ATEC students, the arts and technology students, run away, want to move in the opposite direction of where the code is. I mean, it's great that everybody must code, but that's a hard sell. And so from talking to the students over the past year since I came down to Dallas, they find computing very abstract. And it is kind of abstract, but we're going to talk about what abstract means. And I want to sort of suggest that the word abstract might mean different things to different people. I'm going to suggest something that I think makes the word abstract more palatable. So these are key problems we have to address, and we have to address them within the humanities, within the which is where ATEC is part of the Arts and Humanities School. So that's organizationally how it works at UT Dallas. So here's some proposed solutions that exist right now, mostly within computing. We're going to teach computing to the rest of the world because it sort of dominates our lives from a technology perspective. One is the emphasis on coding. I'm sure that you have come across this. President Obama even had, I was shocked, and he had a video that was about a minute long on why you should learn to code. And there are places like code.org, Year of Code. There's a whole slew of websites that are pushing the code movement. The problem, and I got a problem underneath each one of these proposed existing solutions. Problem is that one way of looking at coding is it's modeling with text technology. It's modeling with print technology. It's a bit of a weird way of thinking about it, but I'm a kind of a modeler, so I do models of shape, dynamics, behavior. You think about it, really coding as it's currently known, whether you program in JavaScript, Java, Python, all the bazillions of languages, is kind of modeling with print technology, as opposed to modeling with some other technology, virtual reality technology, tangible technology that you get from a 3D printer. So it's an interesting, it's something that I would recommend if any student or person wants to try and code, this is a good thing. But I'm saying we need to do a lot more in computing to interest those in the humanities and definitely those within the arts and technology program that is within the humanities where I'm located. So that's the first thing. Second is there are solutions about languages with simpler syntax. Some of you may have heard of Scratch or Logo. Logo, of course, was Papert's creation back in 1980 when he wrote Mindstorms. And then subsequently, Lego bought out the Mindstorms trademark. And some of you have probably heard of or even used that. It's a nice sort of robot kit that fits with Lego pieces. So Alice, Logo, Scratch, and then maybe higher degrees of interaction, maybe that'll get everyone interested in coding. The problem is, though, there's too much of a focus on what I'm going to call control flow. And I'll explain what I mean as we go through examples, other slides. But there's an interesting aspect of most code is that what you're doing when you're coding, and how many people code in here have coded? Okay, good, excellent. So when you're coding, really what you're doing is modeling an agent. You're modeling a controller. That's the essence of coding from an instructional perspective. You're saying, this instruction, loop 10 times. If something is true, then go over here, and then come back later. So essentially, an imperative programming language, which is what most of the coding languages are mostly focused on control flow. So I'll say something about that in the next slide. But the third bullet point is there's also the LOTE movement, which I'm not even going to comment on because I'm actually inadequate. I don't know that much about it, but I think it's not a good movement to have languages other than English to sort of do computing stuff through the back door, I would say, by giving people credit. And I think Texas is one of the states that supports this, but there are other ways, I think, of getting computing into the curriculum than making it so that you can take programming instead for foreign language credit or instead of foreign language credit. It's because there's a lot you can learn from foreign languages. It's about culture, right? It's not just about the syntax of the language, which you all know. All right, so getting back to a little bit of the data flow, it's going to come into this first point. So our proposal, and we actually have an NSF proposal I sent out a couple weeks ago. We're proposing something to, of all age demographics, K to 5. So we're going to try and change K to 5 education, because that's sort of where it all begins. High school, it's sort of too late. They're already inundated with Java. It'd be very difficult to sort of change that culture. So observe. The first thing we suggest is observe, which is to say, my claim is that you can see computing everywhere. You know, I saw it, I went to your art museum. I always go to an art museum whenever I go to any city. And I love this title, Personal Geometry Quilts. Personal geometry, that's a great thing. I mean, you could learn something about math, but where you learn about computing is you build a machine, virtual or real, that does the math, right? So it's kind of one way of thinking about the difference between mathematics and computer science, is we're interested in the process of information flow, whether it be control or data or something else, logic, rules. So I would say we kind of have to, and I've got a picture of a little guy getting out of the box, we literally do have to think outside of the box, because getting back to the code that many of you have used, if it's an imperative language, you are modeling a controller. It's like modeling a, you know, if you were modeling a chef's behavior, it's perfect. If you're modeling a robot, it's perfect. But the information is all around us, all over the place, in this room, the organization of the chairs, the geometry of the chairs, which can be defined as a process to create a chair with a bunch of holes in it in a regular fashion. There's this information everywhere, and so this is one of my pitches. But if information really can be shown to be everywhere, and the process of information can be shown to be everywhere, that brings in new possibilities for the humanities, I think, as well. Because it makes things more cultural. Right, because if computing is thought about as is something that's really inside this box, and it's not everywhere you look, then it's all inside a box, right? And you can't really get you can't get into many cultural connections when everything is inside of a box. Second, we have a big focus on modeling in addition to coding. Right, so the focus on code, I think, is somewhat premature, and I don't think it's sufficient. So I would say it's sort of necessary, because I learned to code. I learned Fortran in 10th grade, and that was my first programming language. So I really enjoyed that, and yet I think modeling is a much richer term than coding. And so, and modeling of process specifically, but also shape, right, this kind of thing, as well as information. Many of you have looked at mind maps, semantic networks, things like that. So those are models of knowledge. And the third thing I'd like to suggest is we need, especially my students, and the students in arts and technology, need to be able to creatively represent the model. So instead of maybe using a diagram, which they might use to sketch out a particular process model, they actually can use culturally appropriate technologies to explore creatively explore that thing. A perfect example of this is, I don't know how many people have played Minecraft. Minecraft? Anybody? Anybody play Minecraft? That's okay. It's just, you know, I've had people say, no, I haven't, my kids have. You know, because it's a new technology. I mean, it's a new gaming environment, but it's actually very brilliant. There's a lot of interesting things going on in Minecraft. One of the things, and this is almost a sociological observation, that the folks in Minecraft over the last few years have built a subculture within Minecraft to do logic circuits. It's absolutely amazing. There wasn't a computer scientist, you know, like me, that went over and said, okay, you all going to do arithmetic logic units and Boolean circuits and RS switches and latches and things. I mean, nobody said that. This is a culture that just from the bottom up happened within this game environment. And speaking of that, there's a similar environment. This is somewhat tangential, but there's a Second Life. Has anyone, I don't know if anyone's used Second Life or played with a virtual environment. There's a Second Life within your art museum. It's a Second Life experience that the art museum uses. But I'm just using that as another type of immersive environment. If you've got a PlayStation or an Xbox, again, those are other good examples of immersive environments. But a lot of learning can occur in those environments. And Minecraft is just a good example, just one example of that. So if people are going to learn computing, the question is, what the heck is computing? It seems like I should be weird. I think I should know the answer to that. But it's a lot of people, depending on who you talk to, will say different things. There's a computational thinking movement within computer science. There are lots of National Academy Press books on what computing is. You can, of course, buy a book on programming language concepts. You can buy a book on software engineering. You can buy a book on automata theory. There's all kinds of ways you can come to grips. But I'm just going to list a few things which I think are essential from a historical standpoint, which is to say, if you go to look at old computers, right, analog computers, the Antikythera mechanism from about 100 BC, and you look at new computers, there's things that they have in common. They all have memory. It may be analog rather than digital, but it's memory. And they've all got some of these abstract things. I'm not going to go over them, but just to say that here's a subset of what we call the core principles. A key point here is that nowhere in this do I use the word digital. Okay, computing, and this sort of goes back to the history of computing, but the essence of computing is not digital, right? The essence of computing are the concept of memory, state, event, time, signal, and so on. So they can be they can be represented using digital technology. They can be used using Minecraft game technology. They can be represented in Portal 2, another game. They can be represented in wood. They can be represented in plastic. They can be represented with people. Us, we could get together and we could do computing. Right, you're the memory, you know, you're going to do a conditional branch, and so on. And that's there's actually a guy wrote a book on that called CS Unplugged, and all the computing is done with people. It's very good for, especially at young ages where you're trying to teach computing concepts. No technology, just human beings. Which, interesting enough, gets back to humans, you know, computers were originally humans. My mother-in-law was a computer. Because that was the term that you know, was a human being. Let's get back to the observed part. Computing is everywhere. So I would say computing is in the lamp in your house. And I don't want to go into the details of this, but if you've coded, you probably are familiar with this, some of this notation and so on. So what can you learn? What kind of computing can you learn from a table lamp? Well, you can certainly learn about Boolean switching. So you can learn about George Boole, his algebra, and you can learn about states, and you can learn about input. These are key things. These are important things, right? You don't need to use a particular programming language to explore these concepts. You just need to go to your living room. But there has to be some pedagogical approach that links things that you see in your living room to, and somebody has to say, okay, look, this is a state, this is an event. And then you have to go outside to the tree growing in your yard, and they say, look, this is a state, this is an event, this is memory. And then maybe after 10 different things, you can go off on your own. And so this is how we plan to teach computing to using kind of more of a model-based approach, and definitely by sensing, by going out into the real world, rather than just by sitting in front of a keyboard. So here, this is just a control flow. This is an old-fashioned flow chart. We call a flow chart in the old days. I don't know if they still call it that. But so there, a lamp, computing in a lamp. OK. Here's computing outdoors where I eat my lunch. So this is one of the things that I would talk to students about. And I'll bring up a few examples of this. So computing outside. Well, there's an array right there. You know, I could represent part of this, the building facade in terms of the windows, the structure is a bit like a two-dimensional ray, right? And I could say, well, we could turn lights on and off, and that could be the dynamics, the process that's going on with that particular array, or it might be that people put their heads out of the windows, you know, or something, or it might be that when the building is going up, the builders have to actually build the windows in a particular sequence. So all of those things are things that are happening over time, which is perfect for thinking about computing, because again, it's all about process and information. The key is to see information, though, not the cement. So that's just a schematic of that. And then we abstract the people into trees. Now, this is done a lot by some of the folks called character riggers in arts and technology. They rig characters for movies. So, you know, a character can move around in a natural way and throw something at somebody. In order to make that happen, you need to do character rigging. To do character rigging, you need to know an abstraction, the abstraction we would call a tree in computer science. So, you can't really see this really well, but this is just a skeletal tree that we use and for representing the human being, and you've got outstretched arms and you've got legs and there's a certain number of joints. And if you use certain programming language, certain modeling languages for characters, you have to deal with such skeletons. But again, a more abstract way of thinking about this is a tree. There's the root of the tree at the hip. And if you just let the body just fall, just the limbs just hang like that, you basically have what appears to be like a willow tree. It has that sort of structure, the body. So again, if you learn about trees, you know, certainly you can go out and you can look at a real willow tree, or you can look at two people coming towards the student hub, and you form that abstraction, or that's the goal. The table, and the table can be seen as a process, right? Because the question might be is, how is this made? And this is often true of sort of the things that you would see that are geometrical, just like the quilt right here. How is what's the process? What's the information process of how this was made? Now, we can use control flow, or we can use data flow. We can use different things. Here's a little picture of a data flow thing. So data flow, and I don't know how many people have used data flow types of models, but with data flow, you think a little bit differently. You don't say, gee, I want to model a controller, a dictator. That's how you, when imperative, right? I want to model a robot. You say, I want to model a system. I want to model a system. There is no dictator. There is no controller. So the way you have to think of computing is very different. You have to think of system modeling rather than modeling of instructions. And this is just a diagram of a very typical kind of data flow model that models the system that is essentially, think about it as being a distributed process, a system that takes planks of wood, maneuvers them around, and at the end of the pipeline, almost like a Ford assembly kind of thing, the end of the pipeline, the table pops out. So that's another way of thinking about the table as a process. I've got the Da Vinci Code. Oh, I need to make sure I've. What time do I? How long should it be? Because I may need to speed up or slow down.
You have another half hour for sure.
Okay, then that's good. I'll speed up a little bit.
You've 35 minutes,
really. Okay, thanks. So I have this model on my desk. And I like it because people like tangible stuff. I like to, you know, hand things to my friends and to students. And so I built this model. It's a model of Da Vinci's cam hammer. But the reason I have it on my desk and I give it to people is I want to show them the mechanical if statement, right? I want to show them conditional branching. I want to show them conditional branching without using a condition that's written. I want to show them the condition that's right here. When you slightly turn this and this cam follower goes like this and trips the hammer, that's identical to the concept of conditional branching in computing. It is conditional branching in computing, but it uses a wooden model rather than print technology. So this is a kind of print technology representation of what's going on in terms of the computing. This is a control flow model, and I have a data flow model, which I don't have on here, that also shows the process going on. But I think, you know, one of the things I think is important with computing is to show multiple representations for things like conditional branching. Because if people just learn that, okay, for conditional branching, I need to say if left paren, some variable, some relational operator, etc., then after a while, conditional branching becomes, you become to think that's the same thing as the text, but it isn't, right? Because in general, if you've got any kind of situation with a discontinuity in nature, if I took a ball and throw it against a wall, it hits the wall. If I wanted to make a simulation of the ball hitting the wall, I need an if statement, because the ball's going to hit the, when it hits the wall, I need to change the dynamics. I need to change the velocity vector, right? So that discontinuity and the idea of conditional branching are the same thing. When discussed in that way, then you see conditional branching everywhere, right? It's not just inside the metal box, it's not just inside the printed program. Okay, some observations that with this general approach is that analog computing is extremely important, I think, to teaching computer science. Generally, it isn't. It wasn't at Florida. It isn't that I know of in Dallas. There's a complex set of cultural and historical reasons why that's the case. It's really interesting, and we could talk for hours on it, but basically what's happened in the academy, it's split off into control and systems engineering in the engineering school, and that's where analog-ish type things are taught, or if you do computer music. Computer music is naturally analog because the musicians were always taking patch cables and wiring these boxes together and making cool sounds. So it's only natural that they think in an analog way. And so a lot of their programming languages are in fact data flow, right? Which is kind of interesting, like Max MSP, Pure Data, and things like languages like that. So analog, extremely important for computer science, and yet we don't teach it. For computer science, I would say mostly we start with Alan Turing. We start with Church and Kleene, and we start with the mathematicians of the 30s and early 40s in characterizing our field. And while that makes a lot of sense, on one hand, we miss out on talking about the Antikythera mechanism, which has got fascinating computing going on within it. In condition with things like conditional branching and so on. So I'm pushing for analog computing to get back into the curriculum. And it's by doing that, you automatically, data flow comes along for a free ride when you do that, because most analog computing uses data flow for modeling and programming. Computing is everywhere. Well, I've already sort of pitched that. The other thing is multiple representations in our observed world, I think, is important. I'll show an example of that in a second. Modeling and simulation becomes important as the center of computer science. And I've got a paper I just got accepted into SIGSIM. That's the organization I chair. But I put out a paper for review, and I got 5 reviews. It was interesting, a lot of really good critical comments, but it's called Computing as Model-Based Empirical Science. So I'm kind of making the argument that computing is also to be observed, right? It gets back to, and that should be out in May and published in the ACM Digital Library. Cultural objects that we can find that have computing embedded deeply within them. This is not just a historical thing, this is a today thing. Can we look at these things today and can we learn something about computing from them? I would say yes. Antikythera, brilliant mechanism, basically celestial mechanics as it was known in Greece about 100 BC, more or less. This analog computer, which was a computer for simulating the solar system as it was known then, was, you know, it looks an awful shape, but they put gamma rays to it and they put all kinds of fascinating wavelengths to it and figured out where most of the gears were. However, some of the gear train is unknown because some of the sections where the gears are missing, and so you have models. Different scientists and historians of science have different models of Antikythera. They're pretty close. They all match in certain parts. They all do the moon and the sun are represented, and those paths are represented. But some of the other things that weren't sure, you know, what about the five planets? Were they represented as well? And this is a modern reconstruction of that computer. So one of the kind of interesting things about this and the 13th century water clock that I will show you is that it's computing, but it's got all this other stuff. It's kind of got design, it's got history, it's got philosophy, it's got culture in there. You get that with analog computing automatically, right? You get all this related stuff, which actually makes it more interesting to connect humanities with computer science and engineering, because you have all these other connections where you can draw on, these related things that connect the disciplines. And it's hard to do when all the computing is seen as being inside this thing. Right, so, but with analog computing, you get some of that. Automata, unbelievably rich set of devices that have been created for an extremely long period of time. And I bring up this one because this is called the Draftsman, and it was featured in the movie Hugo by Martin, directed by Martin Scorsese. I don't know if anybody saw Hugo, but brilliant movie if you like automata. And by the way, I'm talking about automata in the classic sense, not in the mathematical sense, but lots of, I won't go into where all the computing is here, but this is a long camshaft, which is all basically a mechanical probe. It's creating a program with cams. And then you've got input and output. You've got multiplication. Because whenever you've got gears, you've got multiplication, you've got addition, so you have all of that calculation going on within the gear train. So lots of culture there, lots of computing, lots of mathematics, lots of interesting things. These objects are very rich. So some challenges for computing. Should we focus on digital computing only? Okay, I would obviously say no to this. I think it's we have been, and there's no question, digital we wouldn't be where we are without digital technology. But I think to the exclusion of analog computing, I think, is problematic. Again, it kind of depends on how you define computing. It gets back to if you define computing as iteration, conditional branching, those things have nothing to do with specific technologies, right? But if you define computing as, well, conditional branching in written text code, well then, yeah, I mean, analog computing has no relevance to that. Should we emphasize code or model? I would say I don't want to stop the code movement. I mean, it's a good thing, but I think we need to learn more modeling. It's a bridge between disciplines, modeling. And how important are universal programming languages opposed to domain-specific ones? Kind of depends on what gets the job done. And I could point to different computing technologies, but old ones. But if it gets the job done, then it's fine. It doesn't have to be it doesn't have to be universal, right? It has to get the job done. It has to do what you need it to do. Now the last one's a biggie, and this is what I want to cover. Isn't math and computing by extension abstract? We think it is, right? It's why all the ATEC people run away from the computer science department. Partly, it's all that abstract stuff. What's going on with that? So I want to just briefly give you an idea of abstraction that maybe is a little different than the norm. And this hasn't been proof tested in any way, but Let's imagine that abstraction is not an objective quality. It's not a characteristic of an object. So it's not that the equation on a piece of paper is abstract. It's not that the computer program written in Java is abstract. So one way of thinking about this is if you take a look at something like addition, a very simple calculation, we all learn about addition and how to sum things together. And the first thing we learn about addition is we add numbers together, right? And then as you get a little fancier, you add time to it and you add signals together, because that's kind of more fun and you can do a lot of things with time-based signals. But in effect, all of these different things, the two skaters coming together, the confluence of water coming out of the two clay jugs into this little area right here that collects the water coming out here, and the child that grabs two marbles and puts them together in one hand. And this, of course, I wouldn't want to leave this out, are all models of addition. Now, this idea of physical things being models of mathematics is written. It's something I refer to in the ACM paper. But I would claim they are models of addition. And furthermore, I would say that the abstraction is in the process of seeing these water flows, seeing the two dancers come together in the Olympics, and seeing the child's action and saying, you know what, that's all the same thing, right? That's the same mental concept. So if we can imagine that abstraction is not a characteristic of an object, but it's a process. It's a process by which we see these beautiful and individual ways of expression, these expressive things happening, but then we also at the same time we think that's all the same thing. You know, then we kind of go to both poles. We go to the mental abstraction, but we don't just live at that pole. We come back to the pole that is super creative representation of that one abstraction. So I guess I'm a big believer in going both poles, is mental abstractions of addition, iteration, conditional branching, all those good things are essential to understand computing. But you can't get at those abstractions and you cannot appreciate them without all the instances. So I'll just throw that out and the tomatoes can fly. But I think this is important. And so this right here, this creating a marble machine is really that's the third step of where you basically say, okay, I want to use this metaphor based on how I saw addition when the child played with the marbles. I want to use that now to create a new representation that's not typographic of summation. And so I create a marble machine, right, that does addition. So here's a picture. I wanted to show you an animation quickly of this is a quick 2-minute video of a computer graphic rendition of Al Jazari's castle clock. Okay, so yes, that was the title of the original thing, and this is where I'm coming back to that. Al Jazari was a sort of a brilliant artist engineer. It's hard to, you know, back in the days before there were disciplines, you know, people were just everything. You could just say, you know, artist, engineer, psychologist, you know, because there were no deep silos. But he created this machine that essentially was a water clock. So water would come into here, would be poured in by a servant, let's say, or by a person. They would pour water into here. Water comes down into a regulation unit down in here, goes through a series of troughs, which then drives a camshaft, which then drives musicians playing on the other side. But at the same time, there's an interesting information branch that goes on in this, where it drives a camshaft, but it also drives this this rotational this disc up here, the solar disc, and then. But it also, that wasn't enough, you know, for Al Jazari. So he also had a little a person or figurine coming out at every hour, and the doors would open up at every hour. And so this whole mechanism has tons of computing inside of it, and yet is an interesting cultural object in its own right. And so when I had this class, it was sort of an object-based learning episode. We used I'm going to do this. This is just going to be a sort of rotation. So that's the back of the clock. This is the front of the clock with the musicians. And there's every hour a crescent moon goes by and opens up a little door at which time. And there's also a falcon that's a gold falcon that at every hour the gold falcon drops a little bead into the bowl. And so there's all this interesting stuff that's going on in here. And what I really want to say about the classical clock is that it was a way that museums use to teach, right? Museums use this, object-based learning. They take an object and they say, this is an interesting object. Look at the anthropology in this. Look at the mathematics in this. Look at the computing in this, right? It's like a diamond with 100 different ways of looking at it. So this is very common within the museum. If you go to talk to any curator within a museum, they go, oh yeah, we do that all the time, because it's a natural thing for them. In the academy, this is very difficult for us to do, because you're not supposed to be teaching math when you're supposed to be doing history or English, right? Or you're not supposed to be doing this when you're supposed to be doing that. And so this is something we could debate and discuss as well, is will the academy change to where we could actually get credit up to the provost level for doing interdisciplinary things, right? Where they don't, because this kind of gets beyond digital humanities and arts and technology, but if the provost doesn't give you credit and the deans don't give you credit, you're not going to do it. You're going to go, that being able to see 50 different current disciplines in Al-Jazari's castle clock is really great, but I'm just paid to do that one. I'm paid to just dive down into this one thing. So anyway, I sort of tried to defy the odds, and we talked about culture, we talked about language, we talked about computing, and that was the castle clock kind of experiment. And you can go online now, and you can go to my creative-automata.com blog, where I got a whole bunch of things, but one of them is on the castle clock. And if you kind of click through that, it describes in detail the class project of everything that the students did. So we had computer scientists in the class, we had designers in the class, we had artists in the class. So we had a kind of a variety of different disciplines within the class, all contributing in a team to this one project, Al-Jazari's Castle Clock. Now, I want to just take, this is a video that's about 5 to 6 minutes, and I may interrupt once at the most, but it describes kind of what we're doing in our lab that fits this philosophy. So I'm going to...
My name is Paul Fishwick. I am
That's our new building.
Professor of computer science and also a distinguished professor in arts and technology. I'd like to say something about the Creative Automata Lab, which I direct. The purpose of the lab is to make abstract concepts in computing concrete. The first strategy is to find abstract concepts in the real world. And the abstract concepts that we're finding are typically found in computing and mathematics. So that's observation. The other part is creation or creativity, and that's where we take something from what we observe and we use that as a guide for creating a representation, a creative representation of the concept. One of our major projects coming up is called the Lotka-Volterra model, and it's a model of interspecies interaction. One of the creative representations is a web-based prototype or sketch.
I already had this interactive graph, and so I basically wanted to just have my simulation respond to changes that you make in that graph?
What we've got is water flowing in through water valves that control the rate of flow, and the water goes into water containers. And the height of the water in the container.
So I'm just going to say just one thing about this. What we built is essentially three water computers. And there's a whole history behind water computers, fascinating machines that were developed basically prior to World War II. But this is the thing on the left is a water computer, and you'll see the other two students talking about their water computers. Now, are water computers fast and efficient? No. But are they good for teaching computing concepts and math concepts? We hope so. In fact, this is students were basically this water computer composed of two valves here. What it does is it represents a predator-prey situation, like lions and gazelles interacting. I don't know if the differential equation is up there, not on this one, but it's a pair of differential equations. So you have to imagine, you know, if you were going to teach calculus to people, but you didn't want to talk about the type and the typography and the mathematical notation, what could you use using analogy to show this these differential equations? And you can use water computers, which used to exist and don't really exist anymore except in museums. So anyway, and museums and in our lab.
Represents the number of gazelles or the number of lions.
So the whole idea of coming up with a simulation that is more intuitive than just looking at a graph is so that it would give you more insight into how the system equilibrium works.
Another example that we have is an artistic concept sketch. What we have there is the representation of ponds and water flowing into ponds. This water flow into ponds is exactly the same as water flowing through valves into containers.
Rain is kind of the birth cycle, and a waterfall is being a death cycle. So you have the predators and prey being rained into the rivers upstream that fill up a pond to some level. And depending on the interaction between them, you'll see one pond raising or lowering over time.
We're also building a tangible model, and the tangible model is going to involve actual containers of water, not simulated on a computer screen, but real water containers that are plexiglass, so you can see through the plexiglass.
The goal is for anyone who sees that or actually see that model functioning, understands what's going on, and relating that with the equation, you could say, oh, this is doing this inside this equation. If I change this, then this value is going to go lower, and on the next instance of time, this is going to happen, and then you can start learning about it.
We have a few emerging projects that are not directly related to the luck of Altera. For example, we have a student that is doing a model of integration or summation, because in calculus, integration is nothing more than summation with a small number of time intervals or intervals of space. What he did is he created in a game called Powder Toy a simulation of sand flowing into an artificial container.
Well, what I'm actually working on is a physics sandbox, and I'm simulating electronics. The idea is to make a virtual version of a real life machine.
I'm currently working on writing a book and creating a website that is an interactive website that goes along with that book that details the predator-prey model called Lotka Volterra, but in a form that is accessible and exciting for children. Children in this day and age are very technological, and as much as we want to expose them to technology, it's important to understand that the things that they learn in technology, these lessons and, I guess, models that we're trying to teach them, are actually applicable to the real world. As computer scientists, we can take a lot from these older forms of communication to try and find really exciting and dynamic ways to connect with viewers.
We've also got a student that is representing a concept in math called the distributive law. She's making a creative representation of that in three dimensions, but she's also using a force feedback device. So what you can do is you can program this device to provide force feedback to make it feel like something is pressing against you.
We are trying to demonstrate how the properties such as the commutative property and the distributive property work. What I plan to do is have some sort of 3D visual representation of those numbers and the laws and design physical interactions.
To get back to the original two strategies is see computing everywhere. For example, see summation, which is a concept in computing, everywhere. And then using what you see, use that as a guide to be creative about how you would represent summation. And so by doing this, we hope to have a whole new universe of different sorts of creative concepts that are normally very abstractly represented.
So that's pretty much my talk. That's the paper that will be presented in Denver that tries to pitch computing as, in addition to being an engineering discipline, which it is, but to also say, you know, it's also could be pushed to be an empirical science. There's others that have written about this, very famous people like Herb Simon, who wrote the Sciences of the Artificial. And there are those that are key in the ACM community. The current president, Vint Cerf, who actually visited UT Dallas about a week and a half ago. And he wrote some articles on why computing, you know, is computing a science and so on. So this has been sort of a debate for sort of several decades, and I'm sure will continue to be a debate. And that's my blog. I kind of try and post things that are philosophically related to this and stuff that the things that the students are working on.
When you talked about the students trying to avoid computer science,
yeah,
I work with the biology department on campus. And
you don't mind introducing yourself?
I'm Keith Russell. I'm one of the science librarians here at Keith.
Yeah, Keith. Yeah.
And the traditional thing about biologists is most biologists say no to math.
Yeah.
We're doing minimal math. Yeah. But when you start talking about some of these formulas that we're used to in population biology, and they show these long schema formulas, and for most of us, you know, I've had a fair amount of math, but it's real hard for me to say. You're actually visualizing this, but you're talking about creating a 3D analog model, I'll put that.
Of Locke of Altera, yeah. Yeah.
Are you working with the biology department there?
Not yet. That's one of our next steps. We're also working. We're working with the Perot Museum. We're trying to work with the Perot Museum, but we're thinking of taking a simpler mathematical model than something like that, because the Perot is, you know, maybe a model that would be, you know, summation, two signals added together. I need to figure out what model. So I haven't done that yet, but I agree with you. I would like to see whether what they think about that. I don't know what they would say. I mean, those particular models were based on Forrester's system dynamics approach, and I don't know, gosh, I don't know if the biologists have used that type of modeling system or not. They may. I don't know if anybody's ever played with system dynamics, but it's a nice visual analog modeling system for systems. But to answer your question, I'd like to do that. I haven't done it yet.
My name is Stephanie. I'm a graduate student in the history department.
Okay.
So my question is, for the castle clock, are you working with a historian on that, or where did you get the schematics for it? And then also, what's the destination for it eventually? Are you going to...
That's a very good question. So first question first. Historian, I haven't found... Well, I take that back. I did find somebody, historian of... Arabic artifacts, historian of Arabic engineering, the Golden Age and so on. I did email a fellow that I'd never met in person about that, but I have not met anybody at UT Dallas, and I haven't really sought them out yet. Although there's a historian of technology that I have, he didn't know anything about Al Jazari stuff, but his name is David Channel, and his area is history of technology. So that's as far as I've gotten with the history thing, but I'd love to talk with history, and this is a key point I want to make, is it's absolutely essential, because you know, you look at, when you get into analog computing and you go back to something like the Antikythera, or you go back to you know, the chimpanzee bone in which they notched things, you know, creating number systems 20,000 years ago, you have to address culture and you have to address history. And it's not, and the thing is, I guess the pitch here is it's not only a historical thing, it's bringing back history to teach the future. And I don't know if that seems a little weird, but it seems right, at least here, because I think we lose a lot. I mean, we have lost so much in terms of touch and feel. And I just want to note something on history of technology with regard to that. Vannevar Bush, in the 1930s, he was big at MIT. He was, I think, president of MIT, and he was big on the formation of the National Science Foundation. He had a differential analyzer, which was totally mechanical. That was decommissioned but also there was a version at MIT that got like dusted away and thrown away. But Warren Weaver of Shannon and Weaver, the information theorist, he made a specific comment that we've lost something here. You know, we've lost an understandability, a kind of a tangibility that, you know, that even this with its touch screen doesn't have. And I think we do have to go back. I'm answering not only your question, but I guess 20 other ones. But it gets back to history. And I would say, I mean, the main historians that I've, historian of technology, but history of science obviously is another big area with regard to this, especially with modeling, because the historians of science have written a lot about modeling.
First, let me say that was wonderful. Thank you. Your slide where you modeled the universe, not the view from where you had lunch, got me thinking about Heidegger and his essay, The Question Concerning Technology. And mostly to remind myself, but I'll say it aloud just in case.
Okay.
What Heidegger's big claim is that the problem that technology presents to us is that it has an enframing, we are enframed in technology such that the world becomes a standing reserve for exploitation. And his alternative is poesis, is art, right? So I guess I want to ask, are you on Heidegger's side or not?
I don't know. I want you to educate me. I know who Heidegger is, but I've only spot checked a few. I mean, some of the philosophers like Wittgenstein, some I've read a lot more about because he's sort of the link. He's all about language.
Okay.
But tell me more. So Heidegger said, you said he framed. Technology provides a frame, is that?
Yeah, it's a really hard essay to read. His basic claim is that what the rise in industrial and in some ways post-industrial technology of the sort that's all around us,
yes.
What it raises for him is the problem that you start to see the whole world as a kind of, and his term is standing reserve, as a sort of means of instrumentalizing. And that's why the example is your slide where you sort of traced out. It seemed like we could go in two directions. One direction could be that you're asking us to see the world around us, model the world around us as a kind of a thing to be exploited, right? Or you're telling us that we should see the world around us not necessarily as a kind of standing reserve in something that, but rather, so I guess the question is,
the exploitation question? Is that the?
I guess so, yeah.
No, I would say the mathematicians, I didn't talk about math and math education, but they've done a very good job of math. Is math everywhere? Is there math around us? They say yes. This is what's interesting, because computing comes from mathematics and electrical engineering, the most recent computing. So it's a way of thinking, and I wouldn't agree that it's exploitation. I think it's a form of, it's an abstraction that, I would say knowing what sum is, knowing what branching is part of it's an abstraction is sort of part of being human. It's knowing those things is important. To be a human being on the planet, I would say knowing those abstract concepts is important. But I would say furthermore, but you can know them more generally than what you could see in Java or Fortran or, you know, pick your favorite language.
Okay, so
not, I don't like exploitation. No, I don't. I would definitely not think of it as, others might, but I
That's helpful. Your response helped me think of a better way to ask my question.
Okay.
So which came first, computing or the world?
Oh, the world. I would say, you know, it's always a question of where did computing begin. If you look at the historians, Ifra, French historian of mathematics and computing, he has a universal history of computing, and I agree with his point that it started when you started notching stuff on a bone, for example. Bones were handy, right? And luckily, bones last a while, which is why we still have the notches. But that was the beginning, that was sort of one of the ways of looking at the beginning of language and of mathematics and of computing and of technology all at the same time by looking at that. But no, the world, I mean, if you go, that was only what, say 15 to 20,000 years ago. It's, I mean, you know, but it's part of being human. You know, we made the bone because we wanted to talk to somebody, and, you know, we probably did talk, but of course we don't have records of that. But we do have the bone, and we have the notches on the bone. And we can guess, oh, those were phases of the moon, or because that was really important. Still is, but I mean, much more important back then. Yeah.
Okay, I'm Rebecca Blossom. I'm here to visit, so I was really excited to hear that you had a visit and enjoyed what you saw.
I love it.
That's exactly, you know, this is the kind of thing that we're trying to do, is to really open up sort of the many disciplines and the many ways that you can approach our objects so that it's not just about art, but that it is about computing or design or about music. So, do you have suggestions or recommendations? Because we can't do that alone. We have to be able to work with other faculty. Ideas for ways to reach out to people to get them, to make other people see the excitement and the potential of this kind of thinking?
Yeah. I'm trying to work. There's a person at UCL, at University College London, who's the English seem to have a lot going on with the object-oriented method of learning as well. They published a lot on it, and they got a lot of videos on it anyway. And I reached out to her, the curator there, and she's trying to get a grant or something. But I would say, I'm just going to throw a weird idea out there. You know, I saw Second Life. I saw the Second Life environment in the art museum. I'd never seen an art museum have Second Life. I've used the technology fairly extensively in the past. Could that be a virtual way that we could all sort of connect together? It's a social network. It allows us to maybe create things and talk to each other in a virtual world. It goes one beyond Facebook. And it's interesting that I'm mentioning Facebook because of the, I don't know how many people follow the acquisition of the goggles, Oculus Rift. So who knows what Mark was thinking about when he spent $2 billion and bought Oculus Rift. But if you just connect the dots together, maybe it's now is time for virtual world technology, which has been around a long time. Maybe this is its golden moment, and maybe we should be exploiting it as a way to connect with each other. It's the next Facebook, right? It's Facebook, but you can go in it, and you know, there were like 8 people flying around when I was there in the art museum. And that's a place where you can build things, and you can talk, and you can even chat, you know. Would that be a way of doing it? Obviously, there are other traditional ways, like what we have right now, workshops, you know, conferences. Those are ways that, you know, I would say everything, anything and everything. I'm very big on this concept. I think it's really important. But it's a game changer for the academy in general, right?
Well, I think part of the question, of course, is how to meet people, and those are good reasons. But also more, how do we help people to see the potential of this kind of thinking? How do we help people to see, you know, how much this can change their disciplines if they start to think about things more tangibly and less abstractly?
Well, are we talking about seeing beyond the disciplines, or are we thinking, because there are two different things I'm hearing. Or if we're talking about seeing things sort of more tangibly and so on, that's one thing. Because you can still just stay within the realm of mathematics or computing and do 3D printed things and make everything tangible, right? Or are we talking about getting beyond the disciplinary silos, at least for 3 or 6 credits out of 120 that a student takes in a university, and thinks maybe we could use object-oriented learning, which is being sort of pioneered by curators and museum directors. So there are two different things. One is breaking the silos, and the other is tangibility and so on. I would say both are really important, but they're kind of different questions.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was hoping you could talk a little bit about this. You spent a lot of time talking about moving away from text and towards physical embodiment as a way to connect with people and connect with the arts, but yet books are just text, right? So can you just explain a little bit about how you see and they're, and people study them endlessly in humanities, so, yeah.
And could you introduce yourself?
My name is Mike Brandke. I'm the Dean of Engineering at KU and I'm also
Excellent, Michael. We're not going to get away from books anytime soon. I think the tangibility, some of these new technologies and the ability to build tangible things afforded by printing, 3D printers and so on, laser cutters, is moving us. I prefer to say we're augmenting text, because it is a danger to say we're not going to replace the books. Maybe the books will change, and they kind of already are changing in the sense that you got HTML5 and CSS and all that, which is changing the book, right? But I read a paper back on the plane when I came here. I mean, yeah, it's. I like to think augmentation rather than replacement in general, philosophically, and I would say the same thing for the book. It's not going away, but can we augment it? Can we augment text? And text isn't going away either. All these things I'm talking about, you need to program them.
I guess what
right?
I'm
in text.
More thinking about like books as a study in English.
Oh.
Where text itself is something that people are endlessly dissecting. Right?
Yes, but yes.
There's the 10,000 thesis on Mrs. Dalloway, but why isn't there the 10,000 thesis on the bubble sort? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah. I wish there were. That'd be great, wouldn't it? 10,000 theses on bubble sort. In a way, are we talking, this is...
a compelling artifact, even though it's textual.
How is what?
How is the book a compelling human artifact that's textual, but code isn't?
Oh, no, code code, we can't get away from code.
But why is it compelling to people to study?
Code?
In art. No, books.
Oh, books. We're getting back to the books versus the code, right?
Yes.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So why do you have to move away from text and code in order to make it compelling, but yet there's other instances.
Well, we can't.
Human study.
Remember,
the text itself is viewed as almost infinite.
Well, it's the story, right? It's the story. It's all about narrative, right? And so, that's actually Rebecca Tull, who is one of the students. She's making a story out of Lotka Volterra. So she's taking the differential equations, as it were, and she is designing a story that she is writing a book on, essentially. But as you experience that, and it's very, have you played Myst? Or you know about it, the Myst games? It's very Myst-like, I suppose. There are puzzles in the story, and there are people that the characters meet, and the character development is such that at the end of the story, you learn something about the mathematics of predator-prey. But I would just basically say that it's you have to have story. I mean, that's one of the big reasons why I guess games, serious games, are taking off and so on, is some of them have very weak narratives, but in fact, a lot of them do. But still, we're drawn to it. And that's why bubble sort is not, unless you wrap it in some sort of narrative, you're not going to have a 10,000 bubble sort books, but you could make it. Bubble sort could be part of the it could be a solution, a puzzle way or something.
Infinite embodiments.
Yeah. Right. Right.
Yeah. I was just wondering if you touch base at all with Gentry Sayers at University of Victoria.
No.
What area? He runs the Maker Lab in the humanities with about 18 graduate students, and it actually doing a lot of similar things,
okay,
but explicitly from the humanities side. So they create, like, they learn, they study literature, they study history through making and doing, through creating, you know, through Arduinos and Raspberry Pi. Then they also have like they produce these cultural kits that they send out on different aspects of things like historical sound, so you actually recreate things to recreate audio devices, early audio devices.
I think that's brilliant. I mean, I think that's necessary. We are getting, we're hiring someone from Savannah College of Art and Design who's coming in the fall, Andrew Scott. He is a sculptor. He is going to be our maker person. But he's going to be our maker person within arts and technology. He's going to have a huge lab. So we're going to be exploring much more in the tangible. We've just got we have a laser cutter. It's about 12 grand. And we have a couple of 3D printers. But to answer your thing, I don't know the individual you mentioned. But the idea of using that technology as a way to enhance the humanities makes a whole lot of sense. We're printing gears left and right because all of the analog computers were cams and gears, gear trains, the mechanical ones. The water-based ones didn't have those. But, I mean, it's just gears after gears after, and there's so many cool things you can do with gears.
I'm a historian. I'm Luis Cordiguera. I teach history.
Okay.
And, you know, I'm trying to understand how you bring in the history here, and I think the examples you've given have been more like background, like the historians of sciences, which could give you sort of context. But I was wondering, and thinking, you know, again, of that example where you had a picture of the building and the people, and trying to, and I was also taking notes on sort of the language you were using. I was wondering if another way of looking at it was, again, using this concept of computing to establish a couple of things, for instance, relations. And you can look at these windows in different ways, but then you can begin thinking about how they open or they close, and you that way begins to give you a sense of relations, so that, let's say, the chaos of the world begins to have some kind of sense or order. And I was thinking of the development of what would be called like the political science, and I'm thinking of Machiavelli and people after that who begin to take the apparently least thing that you could order, which is human behavior, but they begin to try to establish the rules. You know, if you do these kinds of things, then this kind of behavior happens. If the monarch, you know, takes over, and then they sum it up oftentimes in these kinds of axioms. And they at times get that kind of, not exactly 3D, but then they use these emblems, which are full of symbols, and then you end up with a page which has kind of the symbol, which is what you remember, and it kind of sums up all the sort of rules. Mm. And I wondered if that's kind of also a different sort of conception of some of the things. And again, it's ordering and trying to make sense and establishing relations in something that otherwise just seems random and chaotic.
I didn't talk about rule-based systems, but there's a whole category of rule-based models. And sometimes the computer scientists will call them agent-based models, and most of them are rule-based or logic-based, which is essentially the same thing as rule. And you can create all kinds of order with rule-based systems. I think of things like cellular automata, Game of Life, ELSA's Lindenmeyer systems are rule-based. There's a whole series of models for doing that. But I guess is your question, can the philosopher or the political scientist studying Machiavelli and other books, the princes, and other books of that nature, are you saying can they talk to the computer scientist?
But how this notion of computing is sort of another way for me to understand their own activity. They're trying
Absolutely.
To create models
Yes.
with various rules.
Yes.
And then actually they do create these 3D models in a certain way with these emblems, which have all kinds of little symbols, you know, will have what that means something. And usually it comes on a page, it has an explanation. And the whole goal is to actually see in tangible ways the concept. that, again, turns out to be a rule, and there are these very long books with all these kinds of interesting, but you know, it seemed the extreme situation because it's, none of it is natural, none of it, but it's still, there's that attempt, you know, none of it is sort of water if you push it and things that are not going to move, but even within a super contingent place where human beings are all going to do things, there is that effort to frame things and give them order and meaning and then begin to understand.
No,
I guess it's
sense.
More an observation of thinking yeah. of how that opening up of, you know, this concept of computing could be a way of restating that. And I think what I find helpful with these kinds of things are that it makes you rethink, you know, let's say as a historian, it makes me rethink a little bit, you know, an issue and approach it slightly differently and seeing, again, how a goal, you know, or how there are aspects to this, let's say, history in my case that I haven't thought about because now I can think about them in this new set of relations.
Let me suggest one thing. I didn't really talk about data here, but data is a big deal. Well, big data, you know, but it's a it's certainly a big deal within this. I mean, from a standpoint of flow and process, it's the thing. It's the stuff in the pipes, right? That flows around, but. One of the first assignments I know that I gave my class, kind of related a bit to what you're talking about, I noticed a poster on the outside of the ATEC building. We had a grand opening. This is a gigantic poster with all these funky looking dots. So I said to everyone, go out and observe the poster. Observe what number system. So I had to teach them about number systems and information encoding and so on. And they got into, and I said, okay, now create your own language. They first of all had to figure out what are the semiotics on the side of the building in that huge poster. I mean, the people who created those dots, I don't think were trying to encode any, you know, Da Vinci Code stuff in there, but we can look at it like that. We can observe it as information. We can observe it as data and say, oh, that's interesting. Yeah, I could see the number 42 in there, you know, as a bunch of different funny number, I guess, the secret of the universe. But I mean, it's in there in terms of colored dots. But I would say in general, if you're talking about language and semiotics, that there's lots of rules and there's lots of connections of information theory and theories about data and data structure to exactly what you're talking about. So I would say the thing that pops out in my mind, if as a computer scientist, I would say a lot of what you talked about would it be a natural fit in the way we think about encoding information? Because that's a very key part of what computer scientists do for
us. Yeah, it's also made me rethink in a way that's different than how some people have noted, how people like Hobbes or Bacon, they do science and they do politics. And they usually have thought about it in a kind of different way, but actually, again, this discussion has made me rethink a little bit how they're trying to do in a way a politics of science or a science of politics. You're thinking of your model as kind of another way of talking about it, rethinking.
Maybe.
Anyhow,
it'd be
so it's suggestive.
No, it's good suggestion.